Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining me for tonight's virtual panel, If It Wasn't for the Women. I'm Shaka Myrick, the inaugural two-year Romare Bearden Graduate Fellow at the St. Louis Art Museum. Since 2011, the Romare Bearden Graduate Fellow has hosted this panel celebrating women of color in the arts. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during this program, and we will choose a few to answer at the end. Also, there's a live audio transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. In honor of Women's History Month, I must mention that this annual event is supported by the Mary Strauss Women in the Arts Endowment Fund. In addition to the financial support of this fund, I am honored to be presenting this program under the leadership of the St. Louis Art Museum's first woman and woman of color, Min Jung Kim. Min began her tenure as the director of this awesome institution mid-2021 upon my arrival. Her emergence has been a premier example of inclusive leadership. She is an innovative contributor, and from personal experience, she's a powerhouse in the international art community. She really represents women's history to its core. This year's theme, Hair Sculpting a Culture, was inspired by my personal interest in artistic research and practice. Nearly 10 years ago, I earned my BFA in painting from the University of Missouri, Columbia. While sorting through my old undergraduate work, I noticed a common thread, realizing that most of my work, whether ceramic, painted, drawn, collaged, even the lino cut prints, wood blocks, and screen prints were all centered around Black hair and its evolving history. It became pretty obvious to me that Black hair has impacted cultures all over the world. Tonight, Joann Quiñones, Jada Patterson, and Summer Brooks will discuss some of the contemporary aspects of Black hair in America and across the African diaspora. I will begin this program by acknowledging art where most things begin, the motherland. The St. Louis Art Museum houses an impressive collection of African art, and in honor of Women's History Month, I should also mention that our collection is managed by another brilliant woman of color, Nicole Bridges. As the Morton D. May Curator of Arts of Africa, Oceania, and the Americas, she has curated special exhibitions and gallery installations of African art from all over the continent. Before our panelists discuss their work, I will highlight a few African art sculptures on view now at the St. Louis Art Museum. Let's start with what looks like a portrait bust by an Akan artist in Ghana. Known as memorial heads, Akan terracottas like this one were created after an individual's death, both as a form of commemoration and an object into which the spirit of the deceased might be evoked. In the southern Akan region, royal graves were accompanied by these freestanding clay heads and figures. Varying in size, these sculptures combined individualized features with idealized traits, presenting the deceased as a unique person who embodied beauty and leadership. I am immediately drawn to the treatment of the sculpture's hair. When you look at these works in person, after visiting the St. Louis Art Museum, you'll notice what looks like puncture marks covering the crown of the head. It reminds me of an afro. And there are also coils of clay sitting right on top of the hair that could be curls. The broad forehead and arched eyebrows of this sculpture conveys nobility. While carefully executing the hairstyle, it signifies the high status of the individual. This memorial head dates back to the 18th century, but the sculptural traditions continued into the late 20th century. Next, we have one of the most important and recognizable symbols of the Mende people, one of the largest cultural groups in Sierra Leone. There are two separate societies within the Mende, and the Sand is the women's society. One of the most important events in the Sand society is a girl's coming of age ceremony, which takes place when the girl completes her training and can successfully enter womanhood. The ceremony includes traditional song, dance, and while dancing at the event, officials of the Sand wear helmets, which represent the spirit of the society. The mask is worn over the head, and the rest of the dancer's body is hidden by blackened raffia and fiber cloth. Since the mask serves as a visual connection to the spiritual world, the officials' faces and bodies are not visible, thus concealing any human attributes. This way, the leaders can fully embody the characteristics of the spirit. Worn by women, it's interesting that these helmets are carved by men, and they are displayed and with elaborate hairstyles like this one, which include indications of female fertility and beauty. In this extraordinary example, the formal treatment of the hair has deeply cut and flared hair plaits, but also subtle moments like the multiple rows of cornrows you see here that are rendered in a kind of crosshatching style. We have seen terracotta and metal sculptures from the African art collection at the St. Louis Art Museum. We also have this stunning wooden mask created by an artist from the Igbo ethnic group of Nigeria. Masks such as these are worn by men to represent the Igbo idea of female beauty. With its small, balanced features, elaborate hairstyles, delicate tattoos, this mask has distinctive rising coiffure of tight curls, illustrating the elaborate hairstyles worn by girls from seclusion in preparation for marriage. These maiden spirit masks are worn at festivals that celebrate the deceased ancestors who protect the living in the community. During the ceremony, the ancestors, or the masked male dancers, reappear as beautiful maidens from the spirit world, wearing colorful, tight-fitting fiber costumes and entertaining the crowd with exaggerated versions of women's. The complexity of the hairstyle is conveyed by the carved zigzag patterns, curving lines, and concentric circles. There's almost three movements that are visible, each stacked on another. And it reminds me of the saying, the higher the hair, the closer to God. This work was gifted to the St. Louis Art Museum by Dr. Suggs, a pillar in the St. Louis art community and a civil rights history mogul. Along with African art, Dr. Suggs recently loaned other contemporary works that were related to events in South Africa in our recent Oliver Lee Jackson exhibition. But I digress. Considering the multimedia work that I mentioned, I have to take note of the Baga mask from the West African ethnic group of Guinea. Instead of on the head, these masks are worn over the shoulders. The most important of the Baga art forms are these great masks called Dimba or Nimba. They represent the mother of fertility, the protector of pregnant women, and they preside over agricultural ceremonies. The dancers, again, are wearing a full raffia costume underneath, and they carry those masks on their shoulders, looking through the space between the breasts. With an upright gaze, crested hairstyle, and decorative facial and body, adornments. This mask This mask identifies the idea of a wise woman. Whew. When completely outfitted, the mask towers over the community of adults and children who would be dancing, singing, and drumming to serenade the appearance of the Baga mask. Also, in Yoruba culture, and spirituality, twins are believed to be magical and are granted protection by the Orisha Shango. And this mask presents just that. The Yoruba mask, like this one, portrays all sorts of characters in the community, and they are performed by male dancers at festivals, also honoring women. Twins and their mothers are especially revered in Yorubaland, with the highest occurrence of twin births in the world. The Gelede Yoruba performances are aimed at appeasing the powerful great mothers. As we can see, two oval-shaped heads join at the base, and the hairstyle extends above each of the foreheads, and the elaborate braids are mounted by a crest-like composition tinted with indigo. These sculptures depicting hair using wood, clay, metal, together make up some of the true gems of the African art collection at the St. Louis Art Museum. Without further ado, I am honored to introduce the first of our three presenters for tonight's panel. Joann Quiñones is a mixed media artist who creates figurative work to explore Afro-Latina identity. Selected as an emerging artist of 2020 by Ceramics Monthly, their work has been shown nationally, including in the national NCECA annual exhibition titled The Burdens of History. Earning an MFA in studio art from Indiana University, Bloomington, and a PhD in English from the University of Iowa, Joann is currently an assistant professor of sculpture at Alfred University in New York. Joann, I just touched on how hairstyles have represented status, maturity, and are even seen at memorials in African culture. What does hair signify in your work and personal history?
Thank you, Shaka. Thank you for this opportunity to discuss how hair, the significance of hair, has influenced my practice. I've identified three key areas where hair has functioned in significant ways, personally as well as artistically. One, as a racial marker. Two, as an entry point for discussion on sexuality. And three, as an indicator of disease and aging. I'm going to start with a memory of one of the earliest works I had ever made, and how that piece led me to so many of the projects I have taken on afterwards. In my first year of graduate school, during a period when I was particularly stuck, I found a bunch of kids' toys, Barbies and dolls and the little beauty shop bust design so you can style hair. I decided to paint all the dolls various shades of brown, and I paired each posed still life with a screen printed text of the things folks have felt so free to tell me over the years, from "You're really pretty for a black girl," to "At least you don't have black hair," to "That's why I don't date black women." I won't share any photos of the work, it was that bad, but the one thing it did open up for me was the chance to reflect on my own girlhood, growing up Puerto Rican, but not quite, being an American citizen, but not really, being raised as a girl when I knew at an early age I was that and something else as well. For much of my life, the battles over race, sex, and gender identity took place on my hair, and this has had a profound effect on my work. So for the structure of this talk, I'm going to read what I call short hair stories, five little snippets of memories, conversations focused on hair, paired with discussions of the artwork you will see on the screen. One, my grandmother would sit on the stoop and watch people go by. If she saw a dark-skinned woman walking with a light-skinned man, she would say, "There goes night and day," and she never meant it in a good way. If any of my aunts liked a man who was too dark, my grandmother would say, "I don't want to have to make braids on your children." My very dark-skinned grandmother would hide the boxes of relaxers she used every few months. Two, my mother was so proud of my two little pigtails. I was 4 years old and barely had enough hair to make them, but my mom dropped me off at my aunt's house, my very light-skinned aunt with the very light-skinned daughter, the one with the long brown hair. When my mother came back to pick me up, the pigtails were gone. "What happened to her pigtails?" my mother cried. "I cut them off," my aunt said. "They look stupid." Cultural theorist bell hooks explained the difference between racism and white supremacy as this: racism does not allow for a discourse of colonization and decolonization, or, quote, "the recognition of the internalized racism within people of color." White supremacy isn't just white people, but a political world that even BIPOC folks can frame themselves in relationship to. Bell Hooks states in her own short hair story, "I grew up again in racial apartheid where there was a color caste system. So that obviously I knew that through my own experiential reality, you know, that it wasn't just what white people do to black people that was wounding and damaging to our lives. I knew that when we went over to my grandmother's house, who looked white, who lived in a white neighborhood, and she called my sister Blackie because she was dark and her hair was nappy, and my sister would sit in a corner and cry or not want to go over there, I knew that there is some system here that is hurting this little girl. That is not directly the direct hit from a white person. And white supremacy was that term that allowed one to acknowledge our collusion with the forces of racism and imperialism." The work on the screen now, called De Colores Functions, is what I like to call an autobiographical topsy-turvy doll. In De Colores, six identical doll heads are cast in porcelain and arranged in the line from light skin to dark skin, with the lightest doll facing first and forward and each subsequent doll head facing behind her. The figures are given a Puerto Rican term for skin color: blanca, morena, india, trienia, prieta, and negra. Each of these terms is also associated with hair color and texture. The piece is named De Colores after a popular folk song in Spanish that celebrates all the colors in nature and in society. While the song represents a Latin American ideal, the reality is that all colors are not celebrated equally or in the same way. In my family, a racial hierarchy existed where whiteness and near white features were praised, and black features were at best a source of shame or a problem that could be resolved through hair straightening, skin bleaching creams, or staying out of the sun altogether. And yet when it comes to race, context is everything. Within my family circle, I was considered trienia or prieta and negra to others in my neighborhood who weren't being as polite as my family members. To my Dominican ex-mother-in-law, I was an India with good hair. And to many of my African-American friends, I was a light-skinned black girl. At some point in time, I have been called every shade of brown in this work, but ultimately the whole system of color classification is based on white supremacist ideas. The next work on the screen is El Mito del Regreso. In many ways, this work exemplifies the legacy of colonization and imperialism impacting Puerto Rico and many islands in the Caribbean. The title translates into the myth of the return. A common trope in Latinx literature, many migrants and immigrants would leave home and say they were only going away for a little while. One day, they would return. Many, like my grandfather, left Puerto Rico and never returned. The doll has 17 black legs, and her dress is made up of toiles and silks sold for home decorating. These fabrics, which are often taken for granted, are designed to return us to a simpler, idealized pastoral time. For many in the Caribbean, where a plantation economy was instrumental in the development of the islands, this simpler time was predicated on stolen black labor. I use Puerto Rican tile patterns to reference Spanish as well as US colonization. Short story three. For my wedding, I let my hair grow. I grew it all the way down to my back. After I got married, I cut it to my shoulders, and then I cut it a little bit more, and then I cut it a little bit more, and then I cut it so short, my mom asked, "What's wrong with you? Why are you cutting your hair? Are you a lesbian?" Coming from a very traditional Catholic, patriarchal, Puerto Rican family, gender roles were presented as rigid. Even as a child, I knew that this would not work for me. In the 70s and 80s, I did not have any language to understand myself as queer, lesbian, gender non-binary, or gender non-conforming, as I watched the AIDS crisis decimate my family and community. Growing up, the messages were clear. A good girl was to get married and have children. And so all the rituals of young womanhood were centered around beauty and making yourself desirable for men. As a result, my hair was straightened, relaxed, blown out, pressed out, hot combed, blow dried, and ironed with an actual iron. I had curlers, rollers, bonnets, bobby pins, and hair ties. My cabinet was filled with Milta de Perales hair products, Dark and Lovely, Alberto VO5, Luster's Pink Oil, Blue Magic, Dippity-Doo, Aquanet, and Depp. In another work I consider autobiographical, shown here, Exilio, Exile, the young woman's face floats on the surface of sanded-down beauty magazine advertisements. The black of the windows makes the structure seem like inverted stained glass windows. The figure has hair, but no body, in recognition of the fact that for many Afro-Latina young women, institutions such as the family, church, and state promote a lack of agency or sense of ownership even over one's body. As a queer young person who wanted to be good, denying my own feelings, desires, wants, and needs led to a feeling of exile from the very systems I wanted to be a part of. The next image is artwork inspired by Saint Lucia, Christian martyr killed in 304 AD for refusing to marry a suitor. Medieval accounts of her story state her eyes were gouged out prior to her death. This work is part of a larger series stemming from the idea, what if all these Christian martyrs and saints were actually just queer? Story number four. After the first round of chemo, my hair started falling out. One afternoon, it was so bad, I went upstairs to the bathroom, took out the clippers, and shaved my head completely. When I came downstairs, my mother looked at me and started to cry. I told her, I don't want to wait and just let it happen to me. I don't want to be a victim. I think she understood. At the rather young age of 36 years old, I was diagnosed with breast cancer, and losing my hair, all of it, conveyed to me how much hair played a role in my life, both as battleground and marker of identity. After a bit of fun playing with wigs and fake eyebrows, a weariness set in. If I couldn't just be myself at this moment of contemplating my own mortality, when would I be? How much of our hair rituals have only to do with others' expectations of what we should look like and be like? When in all my life have I ever really been happy with my hair? Watching it grow back, I felt a great tenderness for it. I didn't want to take it for granted. The last work on the screen is called Tucson of Ward Avenue. This particular piece features a life casting of my youngest son in 26 slip casted baby doll arms. The arms are arranged to look both like an afro and a crown. The figure is not quite male or female, and on the digitally printed organza which drapes the sculpture's body are newspaper articles of events that shaped my childhood. The articles cover the earliest known reporting of AIDS as gay men's disease, the shooting of the Capitol building by Puerto Rican nationalists, the LA and Crown Heights riots, the mob killings of young Black men in predominantly white neighborhoods in the 80s, the rise of rap, hip hop, and breakdancing, the importance of salsa music to a New Yorican population, the forced sterilization of Latina women, and the sexual freedom and power as displayed by women like Madonna and Salt-N-Pepa. The tiny hands at the top are simultaneously raised in a gesture of praise and supplication. In many ways, this work acts as tribute and memorial for many young Black queer individuals who have yet to realize their own worth. Currently, I'm working on new projects that involve hair. I'm casting rollers and glass and continue to use extensions, braids, and synthetic hair on my sculptures. A most recent work called The Bodega Soul Dreams, But Not My Own, has plaster squares dipped in indigo surrounded by delicate lattice-like wood frames. The shapes in the plaster are made by pressing objects like hair barrettes and hair ties into soft clay, leaving behind a ghostly impression. I also pressed my locks into the clay. They look as if they are floating in the Atlantic Ocean. And for the last hair story, I turned 42 when I noticed my hair was thinning and starting to gray. A long time ago, I heard a man cry, "Wisdom," when he saw a woman with white locks. I asked Imani, the young girl I love like my daughter, to lock my hair. She sectioned it off and laughed when I told her the woman I went to in Dayton told me my hair was too white to lock. She didn't know what she was doing, said Imani as she braided my hair. Locks are the ultimate test in letting go. Why you want to lock your hair again? She asks me. I don't tell her, but I will tell you. My hair contains all the history of the Caribbean. It connects me to my brothers and sisters of the diaspora. I will wear them until they all turn white, and then I will cut them off before anyone thinks I'm too wise. I still have so much to learn. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you so much, Joann, for sharing your memories and your experiences. These poetic short stories really resonate with me. It's interesting that you talk about inequality within your family while still navigating a queer identity. It is a powerful testimony. Next, we will hear from Jada Patterson. Jada was actually one of the 11 amazing artists featured at the 2020 exhibition, Real Black, A Spectrum of the Black Presence, at the UMKC Gallery of Art. It was actually the first all Black exhibition at that gallery and the very first show I co-curated, a project that was crucial to being selected as the 2-year Romare Bearden Fellow. Jada, it's great to see you again. Do you want to introduce yourself before you discuss your work?
Yeah, thank you so much, Shaka, for inviting me. And Joann, that was really beautiful. I'm honored to be here with you in summer. My name is Jada Patterson, and I'm a multidisciplinary artist based out of Kansas City, Missouri. I'm a graduate of the Kansas City Art Institute, where I received my bachelor in fine arts in ceramics and art history. And I'm currently a studio resident at the Charlotte Street Foundation. The intersections of material culture, race, gender, and history are the basis of my work. But today I would like to focus on ideas of material culture in my work, specifically Black traditions of adorning the head and the body. Hair is a form of adornment I tend to focus on a lot, as it has been important to me ever since I could remember. It is something that has always taken up a lot of my time and energy, whether I was sitting between someone's legs for hours getting it done or dreaming up and researching the next style that I wanted. I remember as a little girl being envious of my sister, having thicker hair than her, hair that I couldn't just wash and go like she could, hair that frizzed and tangled itself. I remember getting a silk press for my 5th grade graduation and hearing a friend comment that I should just get a relaxer like she did. And that night I went home and to my Italian mother and begged her to let me relax my hair, and how she let me do it before entering 6th grade, not knowing better. I remember when I got tired of my relaxer and I wanted to wear my hair natural, but getting teased by my cousins for wearing a chemically damaged fro. I remember feeling bad after hearing their comments, and so I started to flat iron my hair to get rid of the kinks that I was trying to love. I did this throughout high school so I could fit in more, as I started to notice my classrooms had less and less Black students. Eventually, I threw all that in the trash, thank God, and I fell in love with my coils, tangled and all. Learning to love and take care of my hair has been a journey. And the more I learn about its unique history, traditions, and techniques, the more I began to see it as the sacred craft that it is. Black hairstyling and braiding takes the same amount of skill as throwing a clay pot on a wheel does. It also has a rich history like throwing on a wheel does, spanning centuries. On the topic of throwing in clay, what drew me to it was the tactile and therapeutic nature of it. I like that I could feel parts of my body I was sculpting, like my hair or my foot, and transfer that knowledge into shaping the clay. The more I worked with it, though, I found I was interested in creating sculptures with the clay instead of vessels, which is what I was most familiar with. I also found that the languages that spoke to me laid within my personal and ancestral histories, as well as familiar objects and textures I could translate into clay. In this particular piece, I really fell in love with working with clay at this scale and its ability to take mark making and texture and turn it into a poetic device. For me, this work became a meditation on what it meant to me to be a mixed Black woman in this country. Here I created a monumental bust standing about 5 feet tall of a woman who I think of as an embodiment of an ancestor, but also a woman who could exist today. Her braids that extend down her neck represent the tradition of hair braiding that has been passed down from our African ancestors and still exists and continues to evolve to this day. I was also thinking of the women whose legs I sat between as a child who braided my hair and passed down knowledge, gossip, and their thoughts on what it meant to be a woman to them down to me. I look back on these tender moments fondly and recognize their impact on me as I was transitioning from a girl to a woman and finding my place in this world through hearing stories of their lives. Another important part of this piece is the hole in the neck, which represents the silencing of Black women's voices and experiences, as well as the beads that hang from the figure's chest, which represents an ever-present weight. Along with the adorning of the head, I think about the adorning of the body, especially through jewelry and beads that are believed to contain a protective energy. Here, the beads are exaggerated in number, are missing in some places, and bear an ominous weight. My use of beads are not only meant to beautify the figure, but to speak to the weight of being a Black woman in America, the weight we carry from our ancestors, and the inherent bias and racism we are forced to hold and live with. This emotional weight is also due to the fact that a lot of our culture, our style, the way we adorn ourselves was used to belittle us and other us and make us feel less than for hundreds of years. But now today, mainstream culture, they are being used by non-Black folk who wear our ancestors' hairstyles, clothing, culture, I could go on, and in our praise, and perceived as avant-garde, high fashion, and whatever they say, unlike the women who came before us and really paved the way for us. These issues go back centuries, and so the loss of beads in these pieces are used as a metaphor and meditation on the people who were stolen and forced to create a new culture that continues to be stolen and appropriated to this day. So this self-portrait is a continuation of those same ideas I was exploring in the last piece, where the beads seem to swallow the figure and weigh them down, but they are also used to protect the figure. Again, thinking of adorning oneself as a metaphor for the emotional weight Black women carry and the rituals and spaces we must create to protect ourselves emotionally, physically, and spiritually. The head wrap carries these ideas as well on this figure, as I was thinking a lot about enslaved Black women when making this piece who were forced to cover their hair because it bothered the enslavers. I think this weight unfortunately stays with women to this day. At least I know it stayed with me and my family and friends as we felt the need to straighten and relax our hair to appear more Eurocentric, essentially to make others more comfortable with our existence. I think a lot about how wearing our hair naturally and reclaiming old traditions while also creating new ones are forms of resistance. I think this resistance is beautiful and allows us to reinvent ourselves by stepping into our own and at the same time pay reverence to our ancestors. As I transitioned from figuration to other methods of working, I began to use collage as a way to better communicate the nuance and the ideas I wanted to bring up in my work. At the time that I made this piece, I was watching a lot of old films like Pinky, Imitation of Life, to better understand the history of Black folk, mixed Black folk, especially in colorism and how we as a country dealt what we thought was a dilemma through the portrayal of light-skinned Black women in media like film. This is when I really started to interrogate the archetype of the tragic mulatto, hence this piece titled Tragic Mulatto, Keep It Under the Floorboards. This alludes to the portrayed figure trapped in a tragedy between two worlds, having to choose one or the other, or so they made it seem. So with this all in mind, I pressed my face onto a copy machine as an aggressive way to capture my portrait, my dominant features like my lips and hair, and put them on view as if they were an artifact in an archive. The ceramic tiles covering the images have hair pressed into them to signify this defining feature for me and other mixed folks who are often seen as racially ambiguous. Hair covers the piece, claiming its space in this, adorning the piece in a way to say, I am beautiful, I am here, and I deserve to be here. Both the tile and the hair also double as a veil, covering this tragedy, similar to how we have buried histories like this in contemporary American culture. Deep condition furthers this conversation, but more importantly, celebrates the beauty and resilience of Black hair and hair traditions. Though the Kankalan hair I use in my work often is synthetic, it is specifically designed to match the texture of Black hair to blend in with one's natural hair when braided. It is a material that is very important to me as it is used in protective hairstyles to protect the hair from weather, ourselves, and so forth. I see parallels with how we protect our hair in this way, with how we protect ourselves through adornment and beautification like hair braiding and other beauty rituals each day. So opening myself to using this idea of using material as content pushed me and my work into the direction I am in now. In these two pieces here, I use materials used in skin and hair care as a way to further think about protection, but also sealant. In this work, I use Black soap, shea butter, and beeswax to create casts of my nose and lips. Other defining features of my Blackness, not defined by me, of course, but by those who felt the need to tell me so. Over time, one finds different ways to protect themselves from comments like these, the same way we found the plants and ingredients used by our ancestors to protect our skin from dryness, eczema, scarring, ingredients that heal scars and seal in moisture. African Black soap originated in Nigeria, shea butter in West Africa, and both are staples in African American communities to this day. Like hair traditions, these beautification rituals of cleansing and coating oneself with these materials bring us closer to a culture we often feel distant from, whether intentionally or not. Beeswax that I use often in my work is not necessarily a material that we can date and claim originated in Africa, though it has been used for millennia in rituals, cosmetics, medicine, and more. My personal history with beeswax, though, dates back to my earliest memories of watching the older girls in my family get their hair braided. And my favorite part was watching the ends of the braids being sealed. As the last few braids were in sight, someone was told to start boiling the water. After that last braid was finished and the water had reached its boiling point and cooled just slightly, the hair was dipped in the hot water. And for extra precaution, the ends were sealed with Murray's beeswax. And don't forget about the edges, that Murray's was also used to lay perfect curls with a toothbrush. That yellow bottle of beeswax and those memories is what inspired me to create these hats that were gifted to me by the widowed husbands of the women who helped raise me, and as a way to seal in their legacies. Pictured here are beeswax casts of my Auntie Barbara's hat and Miss Lorraine Hamilton's hat. These represent the absence felt when important figures in our lives like these two women leave this world. And I hope that it helps us to acknowledge what is left behind and what has been passed down to us. So this latest exploration in my studio, I feel is a good place to end, as I believe it is a culmination of the work I've been making for the last few years or so. Exploring the traditions of adorning one's head, specifically traditions of Black church lady hats, combines my love for adornment, sculptural form, and material as content. After the passing of my aunt, who was the first lady of the church I grew up in, I was in a different state, missing the community that can only exist in a Black church, missing my aunt and other elders alive and past, especially missing their fashion and elegant hats. The hats that told you what they were thinking by bopping up and down, side to side, or somewhere in between in the church pews. I began to think about the rooms in the homes of the women passed away, filled with beautiful suits, dozens of heels, of course, and my favorite, their extravagant hats, and the boxes they came in. I wanted to remember these women and seal my memories of them and their legacies through this material used to seal our hair and the hats that adorn our hair. Through my art, I hope that I can continue to pay reverence to the women that came before me and carry on their traditions and stories through the hair and beauty rituals they have shared with me and that have helped shape me into the woman that I am today. Thank you for listening.
Jada, I am so blessed to witness the evolution of your work. I've seen same lips and deep condition, but the conceptual connections between hair, style, beeswax, all leading to the hat, they're unexpected, but they really confirm how deep Black hair culture really reaches. The final artist for tonight's panel is Summer Brooks. Summer grew up in O'Fallon, Illinois. She recently completed her senior exhibition, Black Magic, at the McKendree University Gallery of Art. Her art has also been included in exhibitions at the Albert Kemper Museum of Art, and most recently at the Contemporary Art Museum of St. Louis. Her show, New Garden Variety, featured the very works that she will discuss today. If you weren't able to make it in person, today is your lucky day. Summer, tell us more about your work and your focus on hair and its natural state.
So I choose to represent beauty through afros. Afros are essential in a lot of my work. I think that they are so freeing and magical. When we see our hair grow so thick and beautiful from our scalp, we can style it in so many ways. It really connects us back into a natural state of being. The Afro is so essential in Black hair culture. We came from Africa with our hair natural, and unfortunately through Western beauty standards, we have had to change how we view our hair and how we take care of our hair. We have hair accessories, hair care products, but all those things weren't so accessible to us in the beginning. So a lot of our hair and how we identify with hair is very complicated. We cherish it, yet there's lots of politics surrounding our hair. We let ourselves touch our hair, people that we love touch our hair, braid our hair, protect our hair, yet we feel violated when other people touch our hair and when we are not given permission. It speaks on the desires, my work, on the desire to touch Black hair, to be Black hair, to be in Black culture, while Black culture is still very disrespected by many people. We don't want others to touch our hair. We aren't dolls. And that brings me to Crown. So Crown is a figure that is represented using spray foam, and the colors, the way the skin is portrayed is all used to tie Black culture into a sense of royalty. We as in Black people and Black women also often struggle with self-love and self-worth. We see ourselves as less than sometimes because we're constantly being told that our skin is too dark, that we should lighten our skin, we should straighten our hair. However, Crown is basking in her beauty. By the use of purple, it really ties back to how society has deemed purple as a very royal color. The gold often emphasizes the importance of royalty as well. Something gilded in gold is often signified to be something that you want to have. It's sparkly, it's royal. Our skin is represented through brown terracotta and India ink, and this ties back to the use of Black and people of color and the terms we use to describe our skin. We often don't get a chance to see a lot of representation through skin, through hair, And so crown represents the magical sensation that taking out your braids or, you know, wearing your afro, what that feels like. The viewer can get very enamored in the beauty of the afro. And the use of spray foam often abstracts the image of black hair. This figure, Grease, is represented through two figures that are covered in India ink and a mess of spray foam. I like to think of spray foam as an extension of my hair and how I feel with it on days. Some days I feel I struggle a lot with my hair sometimes, and other times I feel really great about my hair, and I just can't wrap around, you know, the ideas of why do I feel like this? So Grease represents the struggle that comes with black hair, wanting to essentially hide in your hair, wanting to ignore and maybe put a relaxer in it. We try to reduce harm as much as we can with our hair by, you know, putting in a different hairstyles, but there's still always a conversation of, you know, black hair politics and whether or not our hair is deemed appropriate for workplace environments, for professional settings. And so this piece represents the self-hatred that can come from our hair. The names I use for these pieces also really deeply connect into black hair culture. Grease is what we call our hair products that moisturize our hair. Crown is what we call our hair, but also our hairline. And jam is also used to define the coils in our hair. These terms, some people have never heard of before. They've never heard of these hair products that we have to use. And so through my work, I really wanted to highlight how important these hair products are. We see these hair products every day. We go into black hair stores, we view it on the shelves, and it's something that is so ingrained in our culture from early on. I can tell that I can remember what the blue magic bottle looked like and how it changed from, you know, nowadays. And so jam continues this narrative of isolation that comes with having black hair. Sometimes, even if you have other people that are enthusiastic about black hair, it can feel very isolating because they might not have the same hair that you have. They might have hair that has a certain porosity to it, and they might tell you to use these products or use this, but it doesn't work for your hair. A lot of the products that we end up using aren't even created by Black people. They are products that are created by other people that might not even have curly or even coily hair. This piece is losing its battle to the self-hatred that it's constantly having to fight. The crowns I used in all of these pieces, all my pieces, even my most recent pieces, are actually products that I use in my own hair. And there are adornments to our braids, to locks and things like that. But regardless of how much jewelry and how much emphasis we put on our hair, we still struggle with these thoughts of self-hatred, and how to overcome that can be very, very challenging. So I try to minimize that hatred that comes from, you know, straightening my hair with a relaxer. I recently found out that relaxers that I've used since I was a child. These relaxers are a great example of how hair products that are created to harm us, whether that be mentally, emotionally, they have been shown, there has been studies shown that these hair products can actually harm us physically as well, causing fibroids in many adult women. And so can you imagine how many young Black girls have been told to relax their hair and now have medical issues that will most likely never get resolved due to the stigma surrounding coily or kinky or nappy hair. So pomade is another substance that we use in our hair. It allows our hair to braid, and it allows for grip and on our hair. It's almost like a wax. And so I kind of like to represent the Afro with spray foam so that it can kind of look like hair that has product on it or hair that has been recently picked out. Although this piece is similar in aesthetic to Grease and Jam, I like to think of this piece as emerging from the spray foam, the Afro, and learning to love itself. This can be a really big healing process that happens over decades. For me, I went from relaxing my hair from an early age on to going into high school and learning to love my hair and to not let the all-consuming self-hatred really take over myself. So pomade is trying to break out of that. And this figure also has India ink covering it. I like to use this very black representation of the skin because we are often called, or I have often been called as a dark-skinned black woman, many different things. And so if I'm going to represent skin, why not just represent it as black without having to worry about the spectrum of different colors that people like to call black people? So I threw my next work through locks. It is a transition and a journey. As I said, I've been dealing with black hair politics ever since I was young. And I feel like my work through spray foam to now more ceramics has transitioned into synthetic to more natural, using synthetic hair products to straighten my hair or to flat iron, to hot comb my hair. And now to just embrace the naturalness of the clay, the naturalness of my braids and my locks. I have come to an understanding that, you know, it is not me I should not hate my hair. It is other people that are presenting that I should hate my hair, that I should not like my features. So locks, I had fell in love with my Afro and I really wanted to represent it with terracotta clay because terracotta is something that we have walked on. It has very deep roots in Africa. If you look at some footage from Africa, or if you look at the pieces long ago that was created, it was often using terracotta and dyed with some type of dark ink to make the figures darker. And so this is what I'm doing with my work. I'm connecting back with my ancestors by using materials to darken my clay, but also letting the raw clay body shine through. I also try to represent the crowns. They are still a strong narrative going all throughout my work. And so Split Ends is a continuation of loving my natural self, but also still kind of like, I'm not sure exactly how to go through with this. There is a thing called the big chop that many Black women do when they have relaxers. And sometimes I feel as if I just want to cut off my hair and start again because it doesn't have the perfect coils or curls, or it doesn't look exactly right. My braids aren't perfect. So there's just this always like, let's cut it off and start over, but I can't always do that. And I have to learn how to take care of myself and my hair and not struggle so much with the perception of what natural beauty should look like. And instead just learn to be okay with that. My hair might not be curly today, but tomorrow I can put some water in it and some jam and it'll be totally fine. We are so defined by our looks and what looks great that it can be a very tough struggle for some people on a daily basis. And this is what Split In represents, the broken hair and the struggle to kind of pick up the pieces and move along. I really want my work to speak about the beauty of Black women and what that we are fighting this uphill battle. And I don't want people to think that we just wake up every day and we get going, or we just do a wash and go and our hair is perfectly fine. There's a lot of pain in history within our work, within ourselves, that many people don't often see. And so we have to let the world know, and through my art, I'm letting the world know the pain and yet the joy that I experience. Western media has definitely shifted what hair and Black culture looks like, but we have to take it back, and we have to let others know that, you know, braids are not just a hairstyle. It's used for protection, and, you know, the clothes that we wear are things that are so important to us. And I really appreciate everyone coming to our talk, and thank you for listening.
Summer, your choice of material and the unpredictability parallels geniusly with this ever-changing mood of styling your Black hair and trying to love it on a good day and a bad day. Also, the commercialization of Black hair care products with blatant disregard for the health of the Black body says a lot about systemic oppression on a deep level. Thank you so much. I truly enjoyed learning about all of your work today. Sculptural work has a special intimacy that drawing and painting just don't possess. Not only through the physicality, but the artist's hand, your touch, is literally imprinted on each object. And when we also consider the implications of those hands, those same hands, braiding, managing, and maintaining Black hair throughout history, it's clear that if it wasn't for the women, well, we've sculpted the culture. Thank you all so much. Now we have time for a few questions. It's not too late to add a question to the Q&A section of this Zoom panel. I have a few listed now. I have a question for all of the panelists. Do you feel your process has a spiritual connection to it? I'm thinking in regards to unlearning white supremacy and coming into alignment with self-love that has been twisted out of us. Thank you for your question. Panelists?
Hi. Yeah, I totally think the process of making artwork, especially I think for me dealing with skin color and hair texture, you know, it really is a process of learning how to love yourself. You know, when I was younger, I always wanted to lock my hair. You know, everyone was getting dreadlocks in the 80s and the 90s. And, you know, I just loved them on other people. And I kind of had this moment of realization. I could be the person I admire. I didn't always have to admire someone else. And I think that's a process of with art making, with really learning who you are, learning your history, having connections and community with other people. Yeah, it definitely is a spiritual process. It makes me feel more aligned in community with people. I learned about racism firsthand through my family, but I've learned all about community through all the people I've shared my art and hair culture and just all the people you choose to love. So.
Summer and Jada, I actually have a question for you two. Do you see your work evolving to interrogate other aspects of anti-Blackness or colorism? Jada, why don't we start with you?
Yeah, can you repeat that question?
Sure. Do you see your work evolving to interrogate other aspects of anti-Blackness or colorism?
Yeah, definitely. I think a lot of like the work that I was making in like, especially through learning how to do my hair was really to connect me to culture that like I felt distant from, or that that I felt like some tension between. And I definitely liked when I was talking about like looking back at like these archetypes, like, you know, like in film, I was really like, you know, a lot of people know about like archetypes of like the mammy, but the lesser known ones are like about the mulatto, which is like the person who is both Black and white, and like the Jezebel, you know, these archetypes that clearly for me, I saw that that being still prevalent in like culture today, still seeing those histories being played out today, and like those inherent biases that with the comments that Joann, you know, spoke about in there. Talk and like the comments of people, you know, making a fact to comment on like my skin color, but also like the, you know, treatment like that like light skin folk get, like there is clearly a divide between, and like a like light skin folk are definitely have like a privilege of being in other folks' minds closer to whiteness. And I think that that is very like an issue that was hard for me to deal with, because I always thought it was the opposite. I always was like, why aren't I dark skinned? Like, why aren't I darker? I felt like something was wrong with me, because that was like mostly what I was growing up around, was being the lightest person in my family and in the room. And so like I always thought, you know, Black, like dark skin and like being closer to Blackness was more beautiful and like what, you know, like I wanted to be. And so then like when you get into the world, and like I said, like going to high school where I was around more, less and less Black folk, I started to like see these things play out in real life, and it was very unsettling. And so I think through my art, I was trying to figure this out, because a lot of the stuff you can't really talk to a lot of people with, especially where I, at that point in my life, I wasn't around a lot of other Black folk when I moved here to Kansas City. And so I just was using my practice as a way to like work through this tension and this, you know, like these projections that other people were projecting onto me.
Summer, do you see your work evolving to interrogate other aspects of anti-Blackness and colorism?
I believe so. In the future, I will eventually kind of touch on other things as I am coming to terms with my own art and figuring out where I want to go. It definitely is a journey. At first, when I was tasked with creating my undergrad exhibition, I didn't really understand that I had such a powerful voice to talk about these things that really bothered me. And as I was thinking about like, okay, what am I going to talk about first? And what really, you know, what's something that's always been present in my life? I think that hair, that, you know, thing, image of hair has always been there, but other things came to mind, specifically about skin and color and the way that, like, when I came to the States, people told me that I talked white and that, you know, I was an Oreo, things like that. And so those harmful stereotypes that Black people told me was being constantly just repeated. And so I eventually do want to talk about that through my work. How it will manifest, I am unsure yet, but I'm still navigating some really deeply personal work. And I think work can be very, it can kind of not be therapy, but kind of be, you know, therapy a little bit, to understand like what those words meant, what those people meant, what people meant when they said that my hair was nappy or that my skin was too dark and things like that. So now that I'm representing it through my work, I feel like I'm just slowly taking steps to continue the conversation of different kinds of things that Black women and men have to face.
Thoughtful. There is a question for all three of the panelists as well. A comment, this webinar has been awesome. Can each artist share how the community can support their work? Can we start with you, Joann?
I don't think I've thought too much about how the community can support like our work or my work. I think it's because I feel a lot of the time that the work that I'm trying to make is for the community. I think, you know, the only thing I always really want is for people to look at it and have conversations with each other. And, you know, talking about internalized racism and talking about anti-Blackness, especially in the Latinx community, I think is one of those things that we've kept really kind of quiet, you know? And so, you know, I think the most important thing for me is that I'm trying to make this work so that we can have these honest conversations with each other. You know, we don't see each other. We don't see each other very well. I guess if there was a way to support the community, if the community could support us, I just would think, talk to each other. You know, I think the hardest thing is that we make so many assumptions, right? Like, you know, if you know, they're Mexican, Puerto Ricans should automatically be aligned. And like, why are Dominicans protesting Black Lives Matter movements in New York? And like, people are really confused. And I think, you know, we haven't done a really good job amongst especially folks of color to really talk about each other, talk to each other and really listen to each other. So all I would like for support is just real conversations, real listening to each other. Thank you.
I agree. Jada, how can we support your work?
Yeah, I've been thinking about this. and I guess the best way is just making space for these conversations to like in this work to be shown, just like supporting and uplifting, you know, artists who are like working through these ideas and like these uncomfortable, you know, like topics that like people often don't want to get into. I think it's just, yeah, like Joann said, like just really talk about it, like sit with the work and grow from it. Like not all art is like meant to be just beautiful and for, you know, aesthetic like enjoyment. I think the best art is art that really makes you think and go and like wanna go into the world differently. And so, yeah, that's the best. And then support us, uplift us, buy our work, you know, stuff like that, you know, like immediate and long-term, like both very important.
Thank you. Summer, how about you?
I definitely agree with both of what you are saying. A lot of support definitely comes from first, like paying the artist, supporting our work by buying our work. That is 100% a great way to support art, to continue the conversation. It allows us to make work and support our studio practice and sustain a lifestyle. But most importantly, I feel as if there just still isn't enough spaces for Black people and people of color to show their work and have these conversations. And every now and then there is like a multicultural exhibition or, you know, some type of exhibition that's geared towards people of color, but I feel like it's still not enough. There needs to be a lot more spaces, a lot more conversations that need to happen surrounding this. And it needs to happen sooner rather than later. This is, I feel like a lot of artists are starting to shift it to very, art has always been very personal, but now there's a lot more people of color that are able to, you know, go to grad school and things like that because of movements like, you know, the protests in 2020 and things like that, where institutions are starting to open their eyes to realize that there isn't a lot of Black people in these residencies, in these institutions, in academia. And now we are starting to get a space for diversity, but this should have happened a long time ago. And now we definitely need to start supporting artists by having more exhibitions, by allowing the, you know, community to see these works. The community loves to see a variety of artists come through, and I think that definitely needs to happen.
I agree with all three of you all. Thank you for sharing your work, Joann, Jada, and Summer, and essentially sharing your souls with us. And thank you all for attending this event in celebration of Women's History Month. The St. Louis Art Museum is now completely open to the public. Come by and view works from our African art collection and many, many other works on display celebrating women in the arts. Until then, thank you for joining us. Have a great night.